That's what I'm waiting for. Three, two, one.
Okay. Well, good morning to all of you that are with us this morning. Glad to see you here in person. And we do welcome the folks that are watching the live stream. I'm going to lift up a few things from the back of the bulletin, which are meetings and so on that are coming up for this week and into the future. Doesn't look as though there's too much unusual or different, although I do want to lift up the study on the Holy Mystery, the Holy Communion that's being held each Wednesday from 6:30 to 8 at Temple United Methodist Church. I think we've had about 8 or 10 people participating in that. And is there from our church as well. Looking into the future, there is a nurture and outreach team meeting coming up on Tuesday, October the 4th. On Sunday the 9th, a luncheon, following which will be an administrative council meeting. As Michael was fond of saying, all of you are welcome to attend that meeting. You do not have to be hold an office or be a chair of a committee to be there. A pancake feed fundraiser, which is Saturday, October 15th, 8 to 1 p.m. in the Fellowship Hall. A trunk or treat, Halloween activity in our parking lot. And there's the charge conference coming up with our superintendent on the 9th of November. Other announcements are listed there. Are there other announcements that we should be aware of? Okay. If not, we will have the prelude, which is On Eagle's Wings. Thank you. He's for it. He's all for it. But he cannot be manipulated. But when sincere hearts who know they cannot do his work or his will without him, praise from the heart and humbly pray, he will answer. Join me now in our call to worship by standing if you're able. Those who love God, God will know them. Those who know God by name,
God will protect them.
Those who call out to God, God will answer. We gather this morning as those who trust God. Our hymn of praise this morning is in the faith we sing with your little black candle, and that is number 2036. Give thanks.
Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks with a holy heart. Give thanks as you give it. Jesus Christ, His Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks. Give thanks, cause he's given Jesus Christ, His Son. Oh, let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich. For what the Lord has done, let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich. For what the Lord has done for us, give thanks. Give thanks to the Holy. Give thanks, cause he's given Jesus Christ, His Son. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks, because he's given Jesus Christ, His Son. And I'll let the weak say, I am strong. And the poor say, I am rich. Because of what the Lord has done and for us. And let the weak say, let the poor say, I am rich, because of what the Lord has done for us. Give thanks. Give
walk with you. We depend on you. today. Come fill our lives with your grace and trust. Fill this sanctuary with your presence. We ask for your glory and your praise. Amen. The word comes from Psalm number 91, verses 1 through 6 and 14 through 16. Living in the Most High shelter, camping in the Almighty shade, I say to the Lord, you are my refuge, my stronghold. You are my God, the one I trust. God will save you from the hunter's trap and from deadly sickness. God will protect you with his pinions. You will find refuge under his wings. His faithfulness is a protective shield. Don't be afraid of terrors at night, arrows that fly in the daylight, or sickness that prowls in the dark, destruction that ravages at noontime. God says, because you are devoted to me, I'll rescue you. I'll protect you because you know my name. Whenever you cry out to me, I'll answer. I'll be with you in troubling times. I'll save you and glorify you. I'll fill you with a full and old age. I'll show you my salvation. Our second hymn this morning is It Is Well With My Soul, red hymn book number 377.
Yeah.
scripture this morning comes from John, Gospel of John, 13th chapter, 3rd through the 17th verses. Jesus knew the Father had given everything into his hands, that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the table and took off his robes. Picking up a linen towel, he tied it around his waist. Then he poured water into a wash basin and began to wash the disciples' feet, drying them with the towel he was wearing. When Jesus came to Simon Peter, Peter said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus replied, "You understand what I'm doing now, but you will understand later." "No," Peter said, "you will never wash my feet." Jesus replied, "Unless I wash you, you won't have a place with me." Simon Peter said, "Lord, not only my feet, but also my hands and my head." Jesus responded, "Those who have bathed need only to have their feet washed, because they are completely clean. You disciples are clean, but not every one of you." He knew who would betray him. That's why he said, "Not every one of you is clean." After he washed the disciples' feet, he put on his robes and returned to his place at the table. He said to them, "Do you know what I have done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you speak correctly, because I am. If I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you too must wash each other's feet. I have given you an example. Just as I have done, you also must do. I assure you, servants aren't greater than their master, nor are those who are sent greater than the one who sent them. Since you know these things, you will be happy if you do them." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
What I am about to share with you, much of it comes from a sermon from a Presbyterian pastor by the name of John A. Huffman, Jr. And you might think it's strange that this was a sermon that was delivered on Palm Sunday. Well, we're not anywhere close to Palm Sunday, but I thought the message was relevant today, tomorrow, as it was yesterday. I have entitled this, "Undeterred by the Crowd." So, question, is the crowd always right? I see Vicky back there in the back. No, and we know that the crowd is not always right. So why do we take the crowd so seriously? They seem to have an influence on us oftentimes. The crowd has the power for good. And in this case, Palm Sunday, the crowd shouts, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." Or the crowd can have great power for evil. The crowd shouted, "Crucify him! Crucify him! Give us Barabbas! Crucify him!" The crowds have a way of making heroes and fortunes for those heroes. And they have a way of destroying those fortunes and snatching them away from the hero who is no longer a hero. There have been cases within professional athletics as well as amateur, but in this case, this particular pastor lifts up the name of Bob Greasy. I don't know whether any of you remember Bob Greasy, but he was Bob Greasy was a quarterback. I think he was drafted out of Purdue University, I think. I'm not sure about that. But he quarterbacked the Miami Dolphins. And when he first started, they were terrible. The fan base was out to hang very critical, they were very harsh. He couldn't do anything right in their eyes. Then they got a new coach. And this coach was Don Shula.
Mm.
I think he coached maybe the only professional team, national football team, to ever go undefeated. And they went on a roll. And this bum, Bob Greasy, became the toast of Miami. He got big contracts. He got big endorsements. He was grand marshal in parades. He was wined and dined and interviewed on television. Became a hero. A bum one day, a hero the next, a bum when all is said and done. And then Terry Bradshaw, we know Terry Bradshaw. Terry quarterbacked the Pittsburgh Steelers for a number of years to 4 Super Bowls. And yet the sports writers and the fans called him a bum, that he was stupid and dumb. It's a little hard to see how you could win 4 Super Bowls and be that dumb. But Terry has indicated that where he parked his car in the parking garage, there was a young lady there, and he said, if I had a bad game the week before, this young lady would just kind of give him the cold shoulder and frown at him. If he had a good game, she'd have a big smile for him. How things can turn. He mentioned that one day he had gassed up his car, and as he was getting in the car to depart, a couple of teenager boys came running up to the car and kind of pounding on the window rather vigorously. And so Terry thought, they're here to get my autograph. So he was going to graciously honor their request. He rolled down the window and they spit in his face. Professional athletes who endure the swings and the barbs and the criticism and the cries to ride them out of town on a rail to tar and feather them, say they have to shut out that noise, they call it noise. A little bit tough to do, I think. Shutting out the noise, not being swayed or deterred by the noise of the crowd. Well, just what is the power of the crowd? The big crowd has the power to bestow celebrity on an individual. The crowd determines whether or not you're popular. We all remember Michael Jackson, who wore the sparkly glove and the hat. Quite a dancer, not a bad singer, but he's kind of faded from view. His celebrity has, the light has pretty much gone out. Hollywood Henderson, another professional football player. I think he was a linebacker for the Dallas Cowboys. And I think he might have been one of the early ones to kind of do a celebration in the end zone. If there was, you know, he managed to accomplish a rather good play, and he would spike the ball violently to the ground. He was a pretty good ball player, but the world overcame him. He got into heroin and into crime and spent many years in prison. The cheers for Hollywood Henderson died out. We know Sally Field, the Flying Nun, Martha, what was the other one? She got an Oscar for it. I'm blanking on the name of the title of the movie right now.
Smoking the Bandit?
What's that?
Smoking the Bandit?
I don't think so.
Martha Ray? No, Martha, what was it?
Martha's Venue?
Something Ray. Anyway, she got an Oscar for this performance as the best actress. And when she received the Oscar, she said, I've wanted more first time when she received an Arthur Oscar, I didn't feel it. But this time, I feel it, and I can't deny the fact that you like me. You really like me. Well, Reverend Huffman says, hang on tight to that Oscar, Sally. That fame will fade, and you may be an afterthought. The crowd pushes and pulls us at times. Sometimes we find ourselves going backward when we're trying to go forward. And sometimes we may even end up going sideways. I'm not getting where I want to be. Sometimes the crowd might hand us a palm branch and force us to cry out, Hosanna! But what I prefer to shout may be crucified. The smart thing to do is to play it safe and shout whatever the crowd is shouting. Our Sunday school lesson today had the phrase, go along to get along. Sometimes the crowd will hand us a placard reading down with the so-called King of the Jews, crucifying. Crucifying, for Jesus is the biggest hoax to come around. His memory is a ripoff. But if I prefer to shout Hosanna, I am better off to play it safe and not get too excited about the Messiah. After all, that's not the sophisticated thing to do. That's not what the crowd is doing. And the crowd doesn't tolerate diversity very well. Well, who can it be that is undeterred by the crowd? Well, his name is Jesus. Take a good look at him. The rumor is that there were some rather strange circumstances around his birth. His parents took him to Egypt. He finally returned to Nazareth, where he played among the wood shavings of his father's woodworking shop, carpenter shop. He was a precocious kid. He was found in the temple among the religious leaders, asking questions, showing great insight. Not much, if anything, is said about his childhood much, except that it can be presumed that there was a certain amount of balanced living, that he was disciplined physically, mentally, spiritually, and socially, baptized in the Jordan River by his cousin John. He was tempted in the wilderness by Satan, rejected by the citizens of Nazareth. Somehow he just didn't fit. Bluntly speaking, it didn't take a whole lot of anything to make it from the power centers of the world. Initially, in the various towns surrounding the Sea of Galilee, he gave what some have called his Sermon on the Mount. He healed the sick, he threw out demons from those with damaged emotions, he taught, he forgave, he predicted his own death once, then twice, then three times. He said he needed to go through Samaria when a good Jew wouldn't dare go through Samaria. He had just had to meet that woman of dubious reputation. Rabbis didn't talk to women like that, nor did they defend other women caught in acts of adultery. And he set his face and passed toward Jerusalem. Now his disciples knew the danger lurked there for him, and they urged him not to go. But he went anyway. And he rode a beast of burden, a little donkey, into the city, rather than a majestic steed. Some loved him, some were curious, some just purely hated him. The crowds gave a strange way of producing a common denominator. That day it was Hosannas. The cheers were loud. The applause was deafening. Garlands of flowers were thrown in his direction, and branches waved in his honor. Hopes sprung inside the hearts of the oppressed people who were under the foreign oppression. Jesus said very little. He made his way to the temple, and in the days that followed, there disrupted whatever mingled hopes the crowd had for him. He threw the money changers out of the temple, and he alienated the religious establishment. He predicted the destruction of Jerusalem and its great temple. Instead of the defeat of Rome, he wouldn't let go in his attack upon religious leaders. He told stories. These stories were shocking, not like the stories they were used to hearing. Who in the world does he think he is? He told us of days when children would turn upon their parents and parents would turn upon their children. He told of warfare, desolation, and human suffering. He wept. He shared his last supper with his disciples. He told them events to come that were confusing. He talked about leaving them. He told them how it was necessary that he would die and then rise again. Then he would leave them and send the Comforter. He told of many who would believe in him because of their faithfulness. Then he led them on a walk down the hillside of Mount Zion, through Mount Moriah, through the Kindred Valley, over to the Garden of Gethsemane on the Mount of Olives. He left them there to pray. He came back and found them sleeping. Again, he prayed with enormous intensity. Then it happened. The torches could be seen winding down that same hillside, coming their direction. They got closer, and that black night procession got closer to the point they could see those faces in the flickering, like soldiers, priests, and one of their own, Judas. Then a kiss, it seemed so friendly, followed by a marked word of arrest, a brief altercation, and the disciples fled as Jesus was jostled back along the pathway to the house of Caiaphas. His long night of abuse and religious trial, early in the next morning, the political trial, followed by a crown of thorns, the sentence of death, the crude torture, and the sneers and the jeering. No hosannas today. This time was the cry, "Crucify him, give us Barabbas." So he trudged wearily, carrying the cross for Golgotha. Racked with pain, his body was jostled into an awkward, wrenching position on that cross. How they sneered, that crowd, how awful they were. Huddled to the one side was a ragtag group of his followers, including his mother and a man named John. He said some things, not too audibly, then he died. The sword was thrust into his side, and the two others taken down from those crosses. Someone, fortunately, loaned him a tomb. But there's more to the story. The appearance to over 500 over the next few weeks, the giving of the Great Commission, the promise of the Holy Spirit, the assurance of his second coming, his ascension into heaven. Yes, Jesus was undeterred by the crowd. He simply didn't do it their way. He marched to a different drumbeat, and as a result, our whole world is different. And just what are the signs of a person that is undeterred by the crowd? Well, there are five of them. Jesus knew who he was. He was the Son of God, the Son of Man. Human and yet divine, and he was sent in to save the world. Number two, the second sign, he could accept praise without getting the swell head. He accepted the hosannas with humility, Why? Because he could see through the crowd. He understood crowds. He knew those who were loyal to him. He could tell who the potters were, who were waiting for a better day in which to get it. He could also identify the majority who simply love or hate and will wave whatever placards they happen to hand, balloons, shoot off whatever fireworks you had to hand to them. He knew there'd be good times and bad. He was probably most impressed by the simple trust of children. In times past, he had said, of such is the kingdom of heaven. Do we accept praise without our head getting turned by it? Or do we understand fickle crowds, how they can be, and find ourselves shocked when people you trust let you down? Thirdly, Jesus could accept without being destroyed by it. Why? Because he knew he was right. He could handle, on the one hand, the hosannas. On the other hand, he could face the spittle. In both extremes, he could look with loving eyes upon people driven by their emotions, mocked by their lack of understanding. Think of what he faced. Not only was it the fickleness of the impersonal crowd, one can understand that if one takes the time for serious reflection. But the betrayal of close friends, that's harder to take, isn't it? You know, because we all may have been there at one time or another. Fourth, Jesus faithfully did his immediate job within the context of praise, abuse, indifference, and various mixtures of both. Almost one-third of powerful teaching, which we have recorded in the four Gospels, was done in the several days between Palm Sunday and Holy Thursday. He allowed himself no self-indulgent glory and no pity party. Do we keep on keeping on, no matter what is thrown at us? And fifth, Jesus saw the hosannas to his ultimate atoning work on our behalf. He didn't allow the immediate applause or pain to get in the way of the cross, the empty tomb, his ascension, and his ultimate second coming. Can we see our ultimate task and fulfill it? Does the crowd orchestrate for us? And in fact, our will for doing it. The final question is there possibly another who is undeterred by the crowd? And could that possibly be us? Let us pray. Holy God, we thank you for Jesus, that Jesus was undeterred by the crowd. He never forgot who he was and why he was here. His atoning work on the cross is our salvation. We are extremely grateful to you and to your Son, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
To the word that is in our red hymn book, number 885, Modern Affirmation, in which we affirm once again what we believe as Christians. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is the one true church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith let us now declare. We believe in God, Father, infinite wisdom, power, and love, whose mercy is over all his works, and whose will is ever directed to his glorious good. We
And there, I have a friend that lives out in San Diego, California. She works in one of those five-star dining restaurants. Does not have a drive-through. Hate to say this, does now. Somebody had drove right through a wall and part of their door and crashed right into the restaurant. Yeah, drove right the car right into the kitchen itself. And her name's Jessica, and according to what her wife has told me, Diane for the record, she has said that they're at the hospital. This happened Friday night, and she may not get out till Monday or Tuesday. The damage to the restaurant is extensive, over close to $400,000. And she was just trying to get a beef wellington out of the story I get. She was just trying to get a beef wellington ready to go out when the whole thing went down.
Bad time, yeah.
Yeah.
There's We have a, I have a nephew whose wife just had pretty major surgery. I think that Ruby, she had a tumor which went from her thyroid gland and was touching her heart. Turns out it was benign, but it was like 9 inches by 6 inches. Of course, they had to break open the chest and the ribs and so on, and that's always kind of a difficult thing to come back from, very slow to recover. But she's at home, and last report, she was doing rather well. We remember her and pray for her continued recovery. All right, well, let's go to the Lord in prayer. God of love and of peace, God of joy, we praise you for the many ways you fill our souls with what we need. And our God of love, you are ever present when we feel unworthy. You wrap us in a deep love that knows no end. Forgive us when we are in the habit of rejecting one another or of rejecting our own selves even. You cherish each one of us as your children, no matter how imperfect or fallen we may be. We pray for those who long to know your love, and we pray that you use us to offer love to our heart, to love neighbors. You are our God of peace and wholeness. When we feel torn apart and divided by the conflict of the world, you give us a peace that rises above all understanding. Our hope can be found in your calming spirit. Forgive when we fall into the trap of believing we should look down or separate from one another. Although we can't understand the big picture or why some things happen, we can rest assured knowing that you have it all within your grasp. Your love will undeniably overcome our brokenness. You are a God of joy, and with that we have hope. We pray that you will fill us with all joy as we learn to trust in you, so that we may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. May we be instruments of your joy and hope in a world that so desperately seeks the good news only you can offer. We pray for those who are recovering from illness, surgery, and other medical issues. We pray for your presence and your healing, the healing power of your touch and your presence. We pray for all of these things in the name of Jesus, who modeled your sacrificial love on earth, the one who taught us to pray. Say,
our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done,
on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom,
and the power,
and the glory forever and ever.
Amen.
Closing hymn, our final hymn of response, is God Be With You Till We Meet Again. And that is in your red hymnal, number 672.
Thank you.
this place, from this time, we thank you that you are constantly present with us, and that your Holy Spirit emboldens us and gives us peace as we hear the noise from the crowd, but we remain undeterred, boldly proclaiming Christ risen. In his holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen. All right, folks, just like to say thank you very much for going to be watching on the YouTube channel, and we'll do the Facebook here momentarily, but thanks all for watching. Peace. Grace for peace. Aloha. We salute our men and women serving around the world on our ranches, rios, military, and our veterans. We love you madly. We're out of here. Peace out.